Today, let us discuss the concept of DLC services. As we know, DLC stands for Data Link Control. In the previous concepts, we have studied about two sublayers of data link layer, that is DLC and the MAC. Okay, so the data link layer is divided into two sublayers indeed. So let us see what are the functions of this DLC, data link control sublayer. We know that the data link control, the responsibilities are framing, flow control and error control. So let us see what do you mean by framing and the related concepts. We know that in the physical layer, the data transmission takes place in the form of bits, okay, and then bits are then converted into signals, electromagnetic waves, and then they are transmitted from source to destination. Okay, this is about the physical layer. And whenever this is happening, the communication is happening, there has to be bit synchronization so that both sender and receiver they use this these bits, they receive and send at the proper timings. There has to be some synchronization. However, in physical layer, the message is in the form of bits. In data link layer, on the other hand, this message is in the form of frames. Okay, just like taking one example of a postal system, the letters earlier when we used to write, the letter is the message, and the postal system you will unpack that letter in one envelope. Okay, so envelope, it's like a piece of information which acts as a delimiter, which contains certain information of both your address as well as the receiver address, which is the basic necessary for the postal system. So here in framing, what happens, the message whatever is there is received at the data link layer, it is the message is added with sender and destination receiver address. Okay, the message is included by both sender and receiver address, wherein the receiver address defines where that message or the packet or the frame has to go, and the sender address gives it is helpful for getting the acknowledgement back. Fine. Whenever this in the data link layer, we know that a message will be having it will be too lengthy. We cannot pack it in one single frame. However, it is the easiest one to pack in one single frame, but however, handling that single frame will become difficult because of the flow and the error controls mechanisms. Because of that, the total message is divided into number of smaller, not very large frame, but very smaller number of frames. Okay, now, so what should be the frame size for it? There are two categories. The frames can be of fixed size or of variable size. If the frame size is fixed, there is no need of applying any boundaries to it, where the frame is starting and where the frame is ending. For example, if you're having 8-bit frame, you know that first bit is the start and 8th bit is the end. So no need to define the boundaries for that frame in case of fixed size framing. But however, in case of variable size framing, for example, if you have 20 bits data message, you are divided this 20 bits into 3 frames, out of which first frame is of 10 bits, then next frame is of say 6 bits, next frame is of 4 bits, 10 plus 6 plus 4, totally 20. This is variable size frames. Now, how will you come to know that the first frame is of 10 bit size only? So you need to apply the boundary before the first bit and after the last bit. So in between this, the first frame lies. So in variable size framing, it is required to have definite boundary to define the frame. In order to do this, we come across two different approaches. One is character oriented framing, the other one is bit oriented framing. Let us now see what is character oriented framing. In character oriented framing, obviously we know that whatever the data will be there, it is in the form of a coding system like ASCII codes. And whatever the message is there, that message will be having source and destination address and other control information, as well as some error detection redundant bits, okay, and as well as the flag. All these things are added to your message. How? Let us see. This is the frame format for character oriented framing. This is your actual data which is coming from the other layer, okay. This message or the data, it is enclosed with header and trailer. Just now, as I said, header includes source and destination addresses and some control information, as well as the error detection redundant bits. This is about the header and the trailer. Header and trailer includes this. One more packet, special packet called flag, which is of 8 bit, that is 1 byte, it is added at the beginning and end of the frame to limit the boundaries, to define the boundaries. Flag, initial and end, it acts as a delimiter because we are looking for variable size framing here. So these are the components of a frame in character oriented framing. Okay, it was earlier much popular, this kind of framing, because whatever the data was there, which was getting exchanged between different layer, data link layers, it was only text, so it was much easier. But that time, whatever the flag, 8 bit flag is there, it was selected to be any character which is not used in the text. So we need to choose a flag in such a way that is not a part of the text. That's it. But however, if we send the data, if it is not a text, if it is say some graph or audio or video files, in such case, you know, you cannot select the flag in such way, because any character which you use in the flag, it can be a part of this information. It can be a part of this data. That time what will happen? The conflict occurs when the receiver receives that. It will assume in the data, whatever the data it receives, it encounters this pattern in the middle, it will assume it as a flag. So whenever after start and in the middle it is getting some flag kind of pattern in between, it assumes that it is a flag end of the frame. So the total frame itself is getting modified. So this is the one problem coming across in character oriented framing. So in order to fix this problem, a byte stuffing strategy was added here. What is this byte stuffing strategy? A special character, we add it in the data section. It is stuffed as an extra byte. Okay, this is usually one escape character, ESC. Okay, and even this has certain predefined pattern. You take one example of byte stuffing. Assume you have a data here which has flag kind of pattern. Okay, the problem which was encountered earlier. Okay, flag kind of pattern. So in the format, how it is sent? Message, header and trailer, and the flags. And whenever it is being sent, it is received at the receiver like this. It is sent like this. A flag, whatever flag is there in the data, that pattern, it is stuffed with one extra character, special character called escape, just before this. Okay, we will talk about the second part later. Let us finish this first. So whenever the data encounters flag kind of pattern, escape, a special character is stuffed inside and it is sent. And at the receiver side, whenever receiver encounters such flag before that, so it knows that whenever it encounters one escape character, yes, it has to de-stuff that bag, and it will de-stuff and extract the data, that is flag. Okay, this is one part. What if the data has escape special character, what you are inserting, that kind of pattern? That is also possible. For that also, you just look at this. Whenever that escape kind of pattern is there in the message at the sending side, one more additional escape character is being stuffed before this data. This is the data, this is the stuffed data. Okay, so at the receiver side, it will be simply removed, de-stuffed, and the data, escape data, is extracted here. This is about byte stuffing and de-stuffing. When the data includes flag or special character kind of data pattern inside, how the frame will be sent and received? By stuffing an escape character and by unstuffing or de-stuffing that character at the receiver side.